welcome to Escape to the Country. Now, this tranquil spot and the ancient church that overlooks it is surrounded by myth and mystery and a legend that helped inspire one of our most popular and famous hymns. But where are we and what's the story? Well, join me in just a moment and I'll tell you. Today, it's a long-standing dream that's driving an active and creative couple to search for their country paradise. And they're more than ready to part with their cash.
Have you got your checkbook?
Ah, excellent. That's a good start, isn't it?
And a celebratory tipple is already on the cards.
What do you think about the bar?
Do you think
you could use it for some other purpose?
I think I'd be inclined to keep it as a bar, my dear.
Well, today we are in Cornwall, and this is the rather pretty 13th century St. Just in Roseland Church, tucked away on the banks of this gorgeous little creek just across the water from Falmouth. And it's one of several spots here in the West Country that it's thought were visited by a teenage Jesus who was then travelling with his relative Joseph of Arimathea, who it's thought at the time was a wealthy merchant dealing in Cornish tin. Now, the idea and the legend that Jesus visited Britain became immortalised in the words of the 19th century hymn Jerusalem, written by the poet William Blake. Without a doubt, it is my favourite hymn and has gone down as a national favourite. Well, behind me is the beautiful backdrop of St. Mawes. It's just one of numerous coastal settlements that for many people really define what life is like in this maritime county. And it's worth remembering that no matter where you are in Cornwall, you're never more than 25 miles from the sea. And as for house prices, well, they are often as attractive as the views. Currently, the average price of a detached property here is £277,000. That's some £22,000 below the national figure. Now, of course, a house with a view like that is going to come at a premium. But nonetheless, as a county, it does represent pretty good value for money. So let's meet today's buyers and find out what's persuaded them to weigh anchor and move to the southwest.
Part-time lecturer Heather and her Merchant Navy officer husband David live near Chelmsford, but have been in Essex since the 1980s. They wed just 6 months after they met 36 years ago.
I'd definitely say Heather's the noisy one. She's the one that's outward going more than I am. Although I think I have learnt from her over the years, and we've met in the middle somewhere now.
The couple's two grown-up sons have now flown the nest, and their four-bedroomed mock Tudor detached home is up for sale. Looking forward to their upcoming retirement, Heather and David are planning on moving out of Essex.
I wouldn't say that Chelmsford exactly has a great sense of community. It is literally a commuter town.
And there's one West Country county that has captured their hearts.
I've always liked Cornwall. I started to go down there when I was a baby and sort of grew up going on holidays. And when I go into Cornwall, I feel that it's my natural home, that I've come home. And that's really a feeling that I like and want to keep.
When they make their move, Heather and David are planning on enjoying their hobbies. And Master Mariner David has also got his eye on some new ones.
I'm coming up for retirement age now, so I should be looking for some retirement activities. I've been involved in the nautical industry from the age of 13, and I look forward to being able to give something back to the marine industry, and I'd very much like to get involved with the National Coast Watch Institution, which is a voluntary organisation.
I will be giving up my work, and I would like to get involved with the local community. I would like to develop my art skills as well, and I would like to sort of relax a bit, because I feel at the moment we're living our lives in a very full and very active way. I still like to be active, but in a little bit more of a relaxed surrounding.
All they need now is a sale on their house, and they'll be opening the door to their future.
This move means a culmination of all my dreams and hopes. I would love a lovely home in Cornwall where I can welcome my sons and my grandchildren and we can enjoy the Cornish scenery and the Cornish life together. That's what I want from Cornwall. Happiness, relaxation and a jolly good retirement.
Heather and David have asked us to concentrate our search between the towns of Falmouth to the west and Loo to the east. But before we commence our journey to find them their new home, we're all catching up in Cornwall on the banks of Charlestown's picturesque harbour to discuss the details of their property wish list.
Well, Heather, David, what a place to start our house search.
It certainly is. Look at that.
You know, for a master mariner, come on, look. I think it really does set the scene, and for many people, this view is what Cornwall is all about. Its maritime heritage is writ large right across this glorious county. But let's get down to the hard facts of what it is you're looking for, Heather.
Well, we would like at least a three-bedroomed house. I would very much like a beautiful stone Cornish cottage, but I realise that may not be possible. We don't want acres of ground, but we want something with a little bit of character, and, of course, we want something to accommodate David's head height.
Yes. I mean, I'm just under 6 foot. How tall are you, David?
Just under 6 foot six.
Wow. Obviously, the boys are going to come down and see you. So, what about reception space? Because at the end of the day, that's where life's going to unfold, isn't it, on a day-to-day basis?
Well, I'd like a really nice lounge. I think that's the most important thing. A really nice big lounge where we could have the boys and their families down. I'm not so worried about the kitchen or the other bedrooms, but David would like a study.
Yep.
And if there's a room, it could even be a small bedroom, which I could sort of turn into an art studio. That would be absolutely ideal.
And in terms of garden space, you mentioned earlier we're not after acres.
Yes, I'd like somewhere where I can sit out, have a cup of tea or a glass of wine and some sandwiches, and I'd like somewhere to potter as well. Perhaps David wants to grow a few vegetables. You know, I'd like to plant some flowers and have some tubs.
And you can't do that at sea, can you?
Absolutely not. Total change.
We have got an interesting range of properties here in Cornwall to show you. How much are we going to spend then, David?
Well, our budget for the move would be £550,000, but
wow,
for a suitable property, we could uplift that to maybe 560 at a pinch.
Wow. Well, I am confident that with your very generous 550, or maybe a little bit more, we should be able to find you what you're looking for from the range of properties that we have to show you, including, of course, our mystery house.
Oh, this is exciting. I'm really looking forward to it.
So I'm afraid we're going to have to bid farewell to lovely historic Charlestown and its wonderful boats and its wonderful sea view and head inland to our first property.
Thank you.
Let's go.
Thank you.
For their top budget of £560,000, Heather and David are after a character Cornish home with at least three bedrooms and enough headroom to accommodate David. They'd like a living room great for entertaining and a couple of hobby rooms. Outside, they're after a manageable garden with views, and they'd also like to be close to the local community. Our varied selection of properties will give Heather and David food for thought, but it'll only be after they've viewed each one that its price tag will be revealed to them. The final visit to the mystery house is sure to turn things on their head, but with an open mind, it could be the answer to their dreams. Our Cornish house hunt is taking us to the inland village of Luxillian. Locals are served by a village store and post office, and the village hall provides plenty of social opportunities, as does the popular dining pub. The parish church, originally Norman, was completely rebuilt in the 15th century from granite. One of its windows is a monument to a 19th century architect, whose name is also linked to this detached house on the edge of the village.
Well, Heather, you wanted a Cornish house made of Cornish stone. How about this one?
It looks
like an old school.
Like an old school. It looks really interesting.
It is
an
old school.
I love the stonework. And I noticed it was built in 1871.
It was by the amazingly named Sylvanus Trevail. He was an architect actually born in the village here. He built around 50 schools around Cornwall. When it was originally put together, there was no middle floor, just a huge kind of vaulted space. So the current owners have inserted a floor throughout it.
Well, it looks like, dare I say, a hidden gem you've found for us. So I'm very interested to open the package and let's see what's inside.
Right then, let's open that package. Come on.
This impressive property was built from local granite and converted into a family home around 1970, a century after it was built. Once inside, a long hallway divides the ground floor in two, and it's home to a rather fun surprise feature.
Come this way, guys, because this, I think, is really unusual. Wine rack set into the fireplace. I'm sure you could fill it and just as easily empty it.
We could make a good attempt.
Anyway, this is the kitchen. Nicely fitted. Very simple.
Oh, I like the kitchen. It's very nice, and I like the view from the window.
And very spacious as well.
Really spacious. I mean, they've got this breakfast bar in here, but next door you've got a really nicely appointed dining room as well, if you want to have more formal dining and so on, but I imagine sort of for every day.
Yes, absolutely yes. Ideal. I would like to see the rest of the rooms, though, please.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Of course you can. Follow me.
Beyond the kitchen and past the dining room is the sitting room. And although it's beamed, there's enough headroom for all 6 foot six of David.
Well, the beams aren't too low, are they?
It's high enough, but I'm a bit worried about what Heather's about to say.
It's a little bit too small, I think. It seems to come in a little bit at me. Whether we could get used to it, I'm not sure.
I certainly take your point, but I do think it benefits from the addition of this conservatory here, which I rather liken to the bridge of a ship.
Yes, you could certainly survey your domain from here.
Yeah.
I do like that view. That view is lovely. What I'm thinking about is that a solid wall?
You could potentially open that up. It would become a diner-cum-living room. And there is so many other features that recommend this property to you. But there is also one twist, which I can't wait to show you. Come on, follow me.
Also on this side of the house is a bath and shower room and a cloakroom.
Now, this is a little surprise I've got for you, Heather. David could probably reach this.
Above our heads is a loft hatch concealing something rather special.
All will be revealed.
The pull-down stairway takes us to a vaulted loft room that runs the length of the house. It's bright and airy, so it could provide a perfect space for a budding artist.
My
Yeah?
Yeah. This has got the light that you would need from both ends of the room. This would be absolutely superb.
Oh, look at that smile, you see. I know we had a bit of a downer in the living room, didn't we? But somehow I think, you know, our little graph has picked up again.
I think the old compromise is coming into play here, isn't it?
Well, you know, what you lose with one, often a property will make up for with another. And I think this certainly should recommend this place to you.
It's lovely.
Moving back downstairs and to the other side of the house, there's a utility room and three ground floor bedrooms. At the front, there's a small double, and next door is a single. The master overlooks the back and has its own ensuite shower room. The nature of this converted schoolhouse means the upstairs accommodation isn't conventional. As well as the loft ladder leading to the potential studio, there are two separate staircases, each leading to a first floor bedroom, again featuring vaulted ceilings. That makes five bedrooms in total. But next stop is the garden.
Hot tub, straight outside the master bedroom, for a morning dip.
Indeed.
Outside, the conservatory opens onto a raised terrace with views across the lawn, a pond, and a panoramic countryside vista. There's also a walled side garden and a summer house cum bar.
It's an ideal size, not
very
too
manageable.
Much to look after.
Very, very low maintenance. I love the walls that surround it. You've got a nice sort of tool shed there, very much in keeping, obviously, with the original building. And the views, you know, not bad, really.
It's a lovely spot. It's beautifully quiet. What do you think about the bar?
I think that looks excellent myself.
Do you think you could use it for some other purpose?
I think I'd be inclined to keep it as a bar, my dear.
What other purpose could you possibly have in mind for your art studio? Sorry, David. You've got an art studio in the loft. So, I think this is of interest.
Yes.
But, of course, it will come down to its price.
I would go around about 520.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's probably a little bit more, so I'm going 525.
So if it was £500,000, that makes it very doable.
That's interesting.
That's interesting. Yes. That would give us money to be able to perhaps change it to the way that we might want it. Yes, it's a really good first house.
Have another look at this one, because it is quite cavernous. There's plenty to see. Go on, off you go, and I will come and find you later on.
This 19th century old schoolhouse is under budget, leaving a healthy £60,000 in the kitty. It's got the potential for a great family room, along with the huge loft room and five bedrooms. With the garden comes many additional features, along with those lovely views, and the property is located right on the edge of the village.
When I approached the house, it looked lovely. I loved the stone and I loved the age of the house and the big wide driveway. And then there was the attic space. Well, that was a complete surprise. I mean, I never dreamed I could get anything as big as that as a studio.
Well, overall, I'd feel this house has got a lot of potential for us. I had a reasonably good feeling in most of the house. Certainly the arts studio potential would be very nice for Heather.
How are you doing?
Very nicely, thank you, Jules.
All done?
It's very interesting. A really good first house.
I thought you'd think that. Come on, let's go.
Thank you.
With 50 years at sea under his belt, David can't wait to make the most of the Cornish coastline, which spans a distance of over 400 miles. He has hopes of joining the NCI, the National Coast Watch Institution, a voluntary organisation which keeps a visual watch along the UK shores to keep seafarers safe.
Tanchan, this is Paul Ruin, NCI. Over.
David and Heather have come to the ancient fishing village of Paul Ruin to meet Richard Hughes, a trustee of the NCI, at one of the 50 stations in England and Wales.
Can you tell me, please, when was the NCI set up and where did the idea come from?
Way back in 1994, two fishermen were tragically drowned off the Lizard. They were in the vicinity of a disused Coast Guard station. The local community were very upset by this and asked the National Trust if they could reopen the station on a voluntary basis. And Bass Point was reopened in December 1994 and NCI was born.
I'm actually a serving Merchant Navy officer. Do you consider I've got the correct qualifications for the job?
David, you'd be in an ideal position to become an NCI watchkeeper. You don't actually need to have previous maritime experience. A lot of watchkeeping is common sense, but you need patience, vigilance, a good pair of eyes. And if we can make a difference in helping to protect and preserve life and safety at sea, then we feel we're doing a worthwhile job and we're passionate about it.
There are 2,000 volunteers like Richard around the country, and he's one of 40 watchkeepers who volunteer here at Paul Ruin. This lookout was opened in 1998 and sits 240 feet up in an area of outstanding natural beauty.
Right. Come on in. Welcome to the lookout. Dan is on a watch this morning. You can see from here that he's got a very good view of the coastline in front and to the east and the west. He's also monitoring several different radio channels. We have a number of optics which aid us in looking further out to sea according to the visibility. These are all important aids to watchkeeping, but it can't spot a local fisherman in distress or a yacht with an engine breakdown or a kayaker or a canoeist who's in trouble. What you need is the Mark One eyeball for that.
Absolutely.
And that's what we do, visual surveillance. That's why we're here.
So, Richard, could you please tell me what a typical day would be like in the lookout?
I don't think there's any such thing as a typical day. Sometimes we come up here and you can't even see to the edge of the cliff, but we can listen to the radio, we can see what's going on through radar. There's always ongoing familiarisation and training to do in the lookout.
All of the sophisticated technology in use here is invaluable, but as Richard says, there's nothing quite like a watchful pair of eyes. And something that makes spotting trouble that little bit easier are these powerful tripod-mounted optics.
I've got the edge of the coastline. Yes, I can see it quite well now. It's very clear. If you see somebody in the water, what would you do then?
Well, the phrase to remember is spot, plot and report. Once we've spotted somebody who is either in danger or looks as if they might be going into danger, we need to plot as accurate a position as we can very quickly, and then we will relay that position by phone to the Coast Guard, and then they will decide on the resolution of that particular situation.
With his marine background, David's training won't be too lengthy if he joins the Coast Watch. And with the organisation involved with almost 300 incidents last year alone, the work he could be doing would be very much appreciated.
You've seen our lookout. What do you think of it?
Very interesting too. I think I could be very interested in joining you when we actually finally move down here.
I should say also that we do have a number of husband and wife teams who keep watch together, and they do extremely well. So I hope we do see you again.
I'm sure you will.
I can look forward to a nice cup of tea then.
Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you, Richard.
Thank you.
David may have all but signed on the dotted line, but for now it's time to press pause on our Cornish journey until our quest to give him and Heather a new address resumes tomorrow. It's the second leg of our coast around Cornwall on the hunt for a country pad for Heather and David from near Chelmsford in Essex. With a top budget of £560,000 in their pockets, we've been given the job of finding them a home full of Cornish charm that also has high enough ceilings for 6 foot six David. Coming up, we've got a surprise in our mystery house.
It is like a five-star hotel.
Yeah. Do you want to check in, I wonder?
And I'll be getting the pick of the county's bunch when I discover why this pocket of the country is carpeted by the biggest concentration of daffodils in the world.
You've got a rubber band already on yours. I haven't even picked enough yet.
Well, our Cornish quest is now heading into its final leg, and with two more properties to come, we've managed to conjure up a mystery house that should offer Heather and David a real slice of grand country living, and that I hope will prove to be as memorable as it is unusual. But first, a property that I hope will really appeal to their love of the coast. And what's more, it's just a stone's throw from this beautiful harbour.
Mevagissey is a village on Cornwall's southern coast. This pretty fishing port attracts tourists to its harbour and narrow streets, teeming with artisan shops and eateries. In the late 1700s, Andrew Pears, a farmer's son, was born here. He later invented and gave his name to a very famous amber-coloured soap. Just 5 minutes' walk from the centre of the village and perched on a hill with views to the coast is our next offering.
That's absolutely magnificent. Lovely.
Have you got your chequebook?
Ah! Excellent. That's a good start, isn't it?
Oh, come on, please. Can we go in?
Come on.
This fabulous whitewashed detached villa certainly looks perfectly in place with its palm tree and its proximity to the sea. It was once a guest house, and with a local history of smugglers, who knows who may have rested here in the past.
I love the double doorway.
It's a classic layout. Central hallway, dining room is in there. But let's start in here. This is the living room.
I just love it. I could see us living here very happily already.
And it's cosy as well.
And it's cosy.
Yes.
It could be our home already.
Wow. That's a great reaction. I wasn't expecting that, to be honest with you, but I'm delighted. I don't need to sell this anymore, do I?
No, we're off, Jules. We're going to...
Go on, then, you can go. Let's have a look at the kitchen. Just to remind you, sumptuous Victorian-style dining room in there. And then this, the galley kitchen, which is sort of appropriate, I suppose, for a master mariner, David.
This would be very appropriate and extremely good to work in.
You know, for a galley kitchen, it does extend this way, which is, I think, really useful. Space for the dining table, nice little range at the end there. But the whole thing is really complemented by this rather useful garden room as well that really does milk those views.
Oh, what a wonderful conservatory. Absolutely fabulous. Absolutely beautiful.
Yeah. It's the bridge. It's your own maritime bridge.
It's my own little domain.
All you need is a ship's wheel in the middle and you'll feel right at home.
Indeed.
Absolutely. I can see all our friends will want to visit us.
Well, let's find some bedrooms for them, shall we? Come with me.
The stairway from the entrance hall leads up to the first floor, where all the rooms are off a wide landing and served by a bright monochrome family bathroom. There are four double bedrooms, one in each corner of the house, and whilst they're all generously sized, the biggest of the four is the master, which comes with an ensuite shower room and sea views.
What a good master bedroom this is.
I love the big windows and the light pouring in.
Mm-hmm.
That's fantastic. There's nothing more I can say. It is a really superb house.
Yes.
Absolutely. Right then. Come on, let's continue. There's plenty more to this place.
Below ground, in a basement level, lies a warren of rooms to give even more options for hobbies and visiting friends and family. There's a utility room, a bathroom, and a shower room, a sauna, an office, and a studio that's currently in use as a treatment room. Outside, there's a garage and a beautiful multi-level garden.
It's a little sun trap.
Isn't it?
It's beautiful. Absolutely beautiful.
You couldn't have done more for us.
I quite agree with that. It's been absolutely a privilege to come round this property.
A privilege?
A privilege, indeed.
Will it be a privilege to buy it, then? Where are we on this one, then, David?
Well, it's a lovely house, a stunning location. I think it's nearer to the top end of our budget.
Yep.
Yeah. I'd go for £530,000.
530?
I think it's going to be slightly higher than that, and I'll go for £545,000.
It's not £545,000, I'm afraid. It's £480,000. For once, you're lost for words.
Good gracious.
Yes.
Absolutely unbelievable. And that would give us plenty of money to do it up.
You did say 480, didn't you?
I did. They are the right numbers in the right order.
That's incredible.
Right then, better wet the ink, mate. I suspect you'll be writing something fairly quickly. Go and have another look around.
Thank you.
Go on then. Off you go.
This wonderful detached house has come in way under budget and gives Heather and David everything they've asked for and more. There's a great living room and a spectacular conservatory along with four bedrooms. The basement offers plenty of extra space, and then there's the garden with all its nooks, crannies and sea views. Location-wise, it couldn't be better situated, close to amenities and the sea.
Well, it's a really lovely house. It has heaps of character. I could see Heather and I living here for a long time to come.
It's light, it's airy, the garden is a real little sun trap. I don't think we could better this.
Well, look at these beaming faces. Happy with the studio?
It's fabulous.
Well, I am delighted at your reaction to this property, and if it were the last property on our list, so far so good. However, of course, there is one more to come.
The Mystery House.
The Mystery House. Can it possibly better this one? Who knows? But I am pleased to think that at least we've got one really good contender on our list. Come on, let's go.
There's nothing more vibrant to signal the arrival of spring to the British countryside than the sight of yellow daffodils swaying in the breeze. And it seems we Brits just can't get enough of them. An estimated 750 million daffs are grown commercially in the UK each year. But it's Cornwall that's the largest producer of this springtime bloom in the world. I've come to meet James Hosking on his 2,500-acre farm near Truro, where his father first planted my favourite flower half a century ago.
I had no idea that Cornwall was the home of the British daffodil.
Yes, I think the climate down here is absolutely ideally suited to daffodils. And it's really because we've got these mild springs, which mean we get the daffodils before everyone else.
They do look beautiful today, putting on a fabulous show. And how many acres have you got given over to daffodils, James?
Of daffodils, we've got about 170 acres.
And how many daffodils is it possible to quantify that you actually produce?
Well, roughly, we pick about 15 million stems of flowers that go to the market each year.
15 million? And how many varieties?
Well, we've got about 400 different varieties. We tend to have a lot of speciality daffodils, as opposed to the Cornish crop, which really is producing the early yellow trumpet daffodil.
These yellow flowers aren't just a pretty face. They were brought to Britain centuries ago by the Romans, who believed their sap to have healing powers. And even today, a substance in their bulbs is used in the treatment of Alzheimer's. The daffodils on James's family farm are picked from the beginning of January through to mid-April. And although numbers run into many millions, they're still plucked by hand.
They just look beautiful today. I mean, that's a classic example, isn't it?
They do, and it is, but that's not what we want to pick. That's how it needs to look in someone's vase. So actually, that's the one we want to pick. It's at the stage we pick it.
The one that's unopened?
And this variety needs to just be showing a little bit of colour to show that that's at the right stage to pick it.
And do you cut them?
No, our way of doing it is what we call pulling it, because what you want is a clean break on the stem, and not a, if you pick it, you can sort of squash it and they curl up and it looks tatty. So our way is no pressure with my thumb, I just grip it in my palm, you give it a sharp pull up and it gives it a clean break on the stem, and also it gives me another inch longer stem, so that's
the perfect bunch. That's, yes. Picks daffodil, one of the 15 million.
One of the 15 million, and 10 of those and that's a bunch. We've put that in our cold store for tonight to cool down, and then it's posted out tomorrow, so in one day's time it'll be on someone's kitchen table or living room or whatever and just starting to open.
I mean, can I just practice the technique on this very pretty head here? Because, you know, that to me... Now, you're saying...
Now, we're saying...
Pull, not pick.
Yes, so you don't grip it with your palm and not don't pinch it with your thumb. So grip it with your palm and just pull up.
There we are, a nice clean break.
Clean break.
Yes. What variety is that one?
This one's called Rosemore Gold, which is a new variety that was actually bred down here at Camborne.
Right then, we better get picking, haven't we? There we are, that's a nice one, isn't it?
That's very nice.
Yeah, there we are.
You've certainly got your work cut out, though. I mean, to get 15 million.
That's right. And then the finish off, I have my daffodils. I want to even them up now, so I give them a little twist to straighten all the stems and get them to line up.
Yeah.
And bring the heads on, and so you just quick break on those. Even up again.
Look at that.
And then that's a nice bunch of daffodils.
You've got a rubber band already on yours. I haven't even picked enough yet. I'm not sure I'm really going to help you towards your total.
I've done it before.
Yeah, well, you certainly have.
Now, James may have 400 varieties of daffs on his farm, but there are 13,000 hybrid varieties too.
It's been a fascinating insight into what is, without question, my favourite flower.
Well, Jules, it's been an absolute pleasure having you here, and why don't you take those home to put in a vase?
I know exactly where they're going to go. Lovely. Made in Cornwall, just like they should be.
Yeah.
Well, there's no doubt that these daffs are a sign of new beginnings. So now it's back to our house hunt to continue our search for a new home for Heather and David. Our final stop is the village of St Clement in mid-Cornwall. Just south of St Clement is the village of Malpas, which sits on the bank of the Truro River where it meets the River Tresillian. Located in an area of outstanding natural beauty, Malpas is a port and is popular for its boat trips in the summer months. 5 minutes away is St Clement, where we find our final offering, which forms part of this grand Georgian home.
Well, chaps, this very steep drive goes to the heart of explaining in part how our mystery house, there it is arranged. What do you think of that?
Is it all of it?
No. You get that cream wing.
I like the style.
It looks Georgian.
Yes.
Its proportions on the inside are Georgian. High ceilings, big windows, loads of light. But in truth, this was put on in the late 1980s.
Right.
Now, it is a wing of an earlier country house, a mixture of Victorian and Georgian, although that bit there you can see is 1940s.
I do like the fact that it's set in nice woodland, and it's totally different to what we've seen before.
It's a slice of mini estate, really. Right then, let's have a look.
This rather grand, semi-detached house uses its elevated position to its advantage, and has been laid out in an upside-down configuration to make the most of the superb views across the Cornish countryside and so win it its title of Mystery House. We're starting our tour in the sunlit living room. Our Mystery House may be turned on its head, but it's not hard to see why.
Well, this is the obvious place to start, I think, and you can see how the reorientation of the downstairs to the upstairs works rather nicely with those views out of the window. And these lovely, really generous proportions.
I do like the layout of the room and the size and the fireplace. I like the fireplace very much. It's certainly interesting and will certainly make us think.
Good. Well, let's have a look at the kitchen. Dining room in there. And then in here. I mean, I think in fairness, this is probably the same size as the living room next door.
This is a lovely kitchen.
I think you're probably right.
Lovely working space here.
they've got this as a bit of a sort of living end. So the whole thing has had a quite recent refresh, not just in the kitchen, but also in the bathrooms too. Come on, follow me, let's go and look downstairs.
Also on this floor is a beautifully appointed bathroom, but it's downstairs where we find the sleeping quarters.
Now, unusually, I thought we might start down here with one of the two family bathrooms this place has to offer you.
Oh, this is a very good bathroom.
Isn't it?
I like the shower.
Yeah.
Super shower. And I know Heather likes the bath.
I like the roll-top bath. That's really nice, and the big radiator beside it.
This, really, is to flatter and spoil your guests with, because the master bedroom, just across the hallway, not surprisingly, has its own ensuite. Come and have a look at this.
It is very luxurious. It is like a five-star hotel.
Yeah. Do you want to check in, I wonder? Come on, let's go up and talk about the price.
Along with this luxurious master bedroom are a further three double bedrooms on the ground floor. There's one with an adjoining cloakroom, a room of the same proportions next door, and another slightly larger one across the corridor. Moving back outside, as well as the private driveway, there's also a lawn garden on the lower level, surrounded by mature trees. But the view can be best appreciated from a raised terrace.
Well, there's no getting away from how intoxicating those views are, guys. Make me an offer for our mystery mock Georgian number.
I think I would give you 430,000 for it.
Ooh, would you?
I'd agree with Heather, but I wouldn't go quite so low as that. I think I'd price this at £460,000.
You know, there is a curious relationship between the estimates people give on properties and how much they really love them. This is on the market at £550,000, or indeed offers in excess of, although, of course, open to negotiation. So go and have a quick run round. Don't take too long, and then I will come and find you and whisk you away.
Thank you.
Off you go.
Our great and grand mystery house has crept in just under budget. It offers Heather and David both light and plenty of space. There are four bedrooms and three bathrooms, and because it's an upside-down house, there are wonderful views from many a window. There's also a manageable garden, and the house is located just a short drive from amenities.
This property fulfills the criteria of the mystery house, most certainly. It's quirky in the fact that it's an upside-down house. However, it's a little bit isolated.
It's very interesting to see this property, though. It's been an intriguing property and one I've thoroughly enjoyed looking round.
There are a lot of nice features within this property, so it does have a lot going for it, but perhaps not enough for ourselves.
How'd you come? Right then, that's it. Our house tours are now all over. You have got quite a lot to think about, I suspect. Shall we go?
Yes.
After you. Well, it's now decision time for David and for Heather. So as a final treat on our trip to Cornwall this week, I thought I'd bring them here to the beautiful Botanic Gardens at Tregothnan. These are just part of what is still the largest privately owned estate in Cornwall. And just over a decade ago, they started growing this stuff, tea. It's the perfect place for a final chat over a lovely homegrown cuppa. Well, this is all very civilised. How are you?
I'm very well, thank you.
A cup of Cornish tea, Cornish scones, and look, Cornish daffodils that I picked.
Cheers.
Cheers, guys.
Cheers.
Mmm. Now then, before we celebrate completely, let's think about these properties, because we've given you, I think, a really interesting range, but I think it will come as no surprise to anybody to realise that there is one front runner. Tell me what it is.
I think you know it's going to be the house in Mevagissey.
Absolutely. David?
It's the house in Mevagissey.
It was a remarkable price.
And in terms of its location next to the harbour, pretty much.
Absolutely splendid. Really, couldn't have done better than that.
Are you surprised to have found a property this week that you have clearly fallen head over heels in love with?
Yes, because it wasn't really a location that we'd thought about. I wanted somewhere with a community, and Mevagissey gives us that in buckets. But the house was quite a surprise. It's got the studio, it's got the study, it's got the lovely large bedrooms, it's got the wonderful kitchen and conservatory, and the view. What more could we ask?
So what happens next? I know you've still got your house to sell. Any movement on that?
Well, our house is on the market, as you're aware. We have been in touch with the agent today. We're informed there's been lots of interest, but unfortunately no concrete offers yet. But we are hoping for that to change soon.
Well, guys, I'm absolutely delighted. I can't wait for you to go back and have another look. I'm sure you will. And then hopefully news that you may have been able to put in an offer. How optimistic are you that that might happen, Heather?
110%.
Right then, David, that's told us, isn't it?
Yes, indeed.
So we might as well toast to your new life in Cornwall. Yeah. It will happen, I dare say, very soon.
New life in Cornwall.
Here's to you.
Cheers.
Well, it is often said that some of our best decisions are made over a cup of good old-fashioned tea, and that is exactly what has happened here in these beautiful surroundings at Tregothnan. Now, I mentioned earlier that this was the biggest private estate in Cornwall. It is also, surely, one of the oldest. It's been the same family since 1334. And that is the sort of legacy that I think most of us would aspire to. And now, hopefully, Heather and David have got the chance to create a legacy of their own. And not just for themselves, but also for their children and their grandchildren in a beautiful Victorian villa overlooking the sea. I'll see you next time.
If you would like to escape to the country in Northern Ireland, Scotland, Wales or England and need our help, you can apply online at bbc.co.uk/...
Welcome to Escape to the Country. Now, this tranquil spot and the ancient church that overlooks it is surrounded by myth and mystery and a legend that helped inspire one of our most popular and famous hymns. But where are we and what's the story? Well, join me in just a moment and I'll tell you.
Today, it's a long-standing dream that's driving an active and creative couple to search for their country paradise. And they're more than ready to part with their cash.
You got your checkbook?
Ah, excellent. That's a good start, isn't it?
And a celebratory tipple is already on the cards.
What do you think about the bar?
Do you think you could use it for some other purpose?
I think I'd be inclined to keep it as a bar, my dear.
Well, today we are in Cornwall, and this is the rather pretty 13th century St Just in Roseland Church, tucked away on the banks of this gorgeous little creek just across the water from Falmouth. And it's one of several spots here in the West Country that it's thought were visited by a teenage Jesus who was then travelling with his relative Joseph of Arimathea, who it's thought at the time was a wealthy merchant dealing in Cornish tin. Now, the idea and the legend that Jesus visited Britain became immortalised in the words of the 19th century hymn Jerusalem, written by the poet William Blake. Without a doubt, it is my favourite hymn and has gone down as a national favourite. Well, behind me is the beautiful backdrop of St Mawes. It's just one of numerous coastal settlements that for many people really define what life is like in this maritime county. And it's worth remembering that no matter where you are in Cornwall, you're never more than 25 miles from the sea. And as for house prices, well, they are often as attractive as the views. Currently, the average price of a detached property here is £277,000. That's some £22,000 below the national figure. Now, of course, a house with a view like that is going to come at a premium. But nonetheless, as a county, it does represent pretty good value for money. So let's meet today's buyers and find out what's persuaded them to weigh anchor and move to the southwest.
Part-time lecturer Heather and her Merchant Navy officer husband David live near Chelmsford, but have been in Essex since the 1980s. They wed just 6 months after they met 36 years ago.
I'd definitely say Heather's the noisy one. She's the one that's outward going more than I am.
although I think I have learnt from her over the years, and we've met in the middle somewhere now.
The couple's two grown-up sons have now flown the nest, and their four-bedroomed mock Tudor detached home is up for sale. Looking forward to their upcoming retirement, Heather and David are planning on moving out of Essex.
I wouldn't say that Chelmsford exactly has a great sense of community. It is literally a commuter town.
And there's one West Country county that has captured their hearts.
I've always liked Cornwall. I started to go down there when I was a baby and sort of grew up going on holidays. And when I go into Cornwall, I feel that it's my natural home, that I've come home. And that's really a feeling that I like and want to keep.
When they make their move, Heather and David are planning on enjoying their hobbies. And Master Mariner David has also got his eye on some new ones.
I'm coming up for retirement age now, so I should be looking for some retirement activities. I've been involved in the nautical industry from the age of 13. And I look forward to being able to give something back to the marine industry. And I'd very much like to get involved with the National Coast Watch Institution, which is a voluntary organisation.
I will be giving up my work, and I would like to get involved with the local community. I would like to do...